CSD impact, global food production, drought, increased unpredictability of precipitation, and rising temperatures will reduce global crop yields. Moreover, warming and acidification of the oceans would affect marine wildlife and fisheries. And I'm drawing attention to this because normally we only focus on food that comes from land sources. The important point here is that most of the food insecure we found in South Asia, where over 400 million poor and undernourished people currently live, climate change will disproportionately harm them. Many Indian rural households depend on agriculture for a living, and if you add fisheries and forestry, the sector is amongst the largest contributors to India's GDP. Moreover, many Indians who earn livelihoods in coastal regions will also be affected by sea level rise. In addition, heat stress will decrease labor productivity and cause substantial food yield and production declines. Sorghum production, for example, is expected to decline by 14%, as per some studies. Moreover, warmer temperatures and more erratic rainfall in parts of India could depress rice yields, which is an important staple for not only India, but the entire region. And the Indo-Gangetic plains, which produce 90 plus million tons of wheat a year, which is approximately 14 to 15% of global production. And there are projections which indicate a fall in yields of up to 51% if you look another 40 to 50 years ahead. Unless, and here are the two conditions, unless there's a shift in crop varieties and change in management practices. So this does not, of course, have to happen, but it could if you don't take corrective steps. All this will lead to higher food prices and living costs, increased drought-related water and food shortages linked to rising temperatures, may also increase malnutrition and worsen rural poverty, which is quite significant in this region. Climate-related food productivity decline will also affect livelihoods and exports. So the impact will be on all stakeholders. And companies and businesses and other meetings that are being held side by side are looking at how to reduce their GHG emissions. But up here, I think we need to look at how we can draw in all stakeholders and see what needs to be done beyond funding and technology transfer. Because, in fact, the key to effective adaptation and developing healthy ecosystems lies in empowering individuals and communities and backing whatever assurances we give them with financial and technological resources. A two-way flow of information is vital. Vulnerable agricultural communities should have the opportunity to share their traditional knowledge and present their grassroots perspective to policymakers. Also, scientific information and scientific analysis, this needs to be couched, it needs to be shared in a simple manner that is appropriate to local context so that it can be well understood. Local institutions need to have a meaningful dialogue with scientists, with government officials, with policymakers, and with community members. There's a huge gap in climate change knowledge. In sharing such knowledge, it persists, and this has led to adaptation information not reaching the most vulnerable agricultural communities. So on one side, you have the negotiations going on, which will continue even post the Paris Agreement. On the other, you need to transfer this information back to people whose lives will be seriously affected and try and help them in their vulnerability to tackle the challenges they face. All of this needs to be corrected. Against this background, food chain reaction organized a global food security game in Washington, D.C. About a year ago in November last year. They identified three critical gaps, and I find nothing to dispute on that in global food systems. In order to create a more resilient, a food secure future for those who are more vulnerable. And as I said, in South Asia, you have perhaps the largest number of food vulnerable people in any region in the world at the moment. These three gaps are identified as the knowledge gap, which needs to be addressed, the productivity gap, which needs to be addressed, and the cooperation gap. I entirely endorse these, and I'm very happy that, in fact, we have three of the participants from India who took part in that gaming exercise who are with us today. Professor Alak, Dr. Partha Mukhopadhyay, and Dr. Nutan Kaushik. I'm sure that you will have useful deliberations I myself am required to carry on to another meeting where I have to chair a panel of 20 out of 100 business persons. But let me start off by at least introducing to you Holly Franklin of the WWF and Kate Fisher of the CNA, who will provide us first through teleconferencing and then through a video some information on flood and earthquake prediction. With these words, I inaugurate your conference, and I wish you useful and valuable deliberations. Thank you.
There are significant risks as we look at the problems we face with regard to food security, especially going forward. Some of the most complicated and some of the most extraordinary challenges that the world has faced in all of its history.
Food chain reaction is an effort to put some of the major actors on this planet who have to deal with a global food crisis.
Food chain reaction was really to create these scenarios based on scenarios that have happened in the past, but how do countries respond to them?
We had eight teams. We had four rounds spanning from 2020 to 2030.
Our real hope was that we would get really great participants in the room, which we did, players from all around the world, to elevate a more global conversation among all of those different worldwide experts.
The game itself created an opportunity to live into the future. It caused people to think through what the possibilities are. And in that process, I think they realized what they have to start to do today to prepare for the future.
We began the decade in 2020. Food prices in 2020 and 2021 are climbing.
The world in 2020 is a world with increasing pressures from urbanization. It's a world where it's getting hotter and it's getting drier. We're also seeing increased social unrest because of the volatility in the food system. All of those factors coming together, creating that perfect storm.
Food security is an issue that affects all of us. If you eat, then you're a stakeholder in how people feed the world.
The challenges and crises that we were assigned are exactly what we expect to see in the future. So you've got famine, you've got increased pests, you've got the role of climate change in the world.
As we face food shortages, it can cause major political unrest. We need to be prepared to address these challenges.
There'll be huge pressure to focus more domestically. But I think collectively as the United States, if we diminish our support for overseas activities, that will be a tremendous signal to the rest of the world to similarly reduce their contributions.
We could send someone over to the Africa room and try to negotiate some, at least, soft targets on climate-smart agriculture.
Africa is the future breadbasket of the world. It has the potential, but it hasn't fulfilled that potential.
We would like to discuss opportunities to promote private sector investments, and we would like your support in identifying how we can leverage private investments into the sector to grow it.
In the first round, we saw the players in a goal-setting mode, and they weren't necessarily being really active in their implementation of some of the things that they thought might be able to address a food insecure world.
The problem's getting worse, the actions are remaining static. That's as bad as you can get.
The world doesn't change just by saying good ideas. You have to move forward and actually do things, not just talk about them.
Things turn worse in 2023. Stress continues to mount in the global food system.
Round two was where we really put the heat on players. That's when we really saw them get action-oriented.
Food prices are going up 400%. We've got a flood of migrants coming in. The world is starting to fall apart.
In the short term, we give countries in sub-Saharan Africa a large gift of fertilizer.
Nitrogen fertilizers will severely affect the soil quality in the long term.
Would we rather avoid new wars or large-scale starvation to save 3 years or 4 years of ecosystem services?
There are no good choices in the situation they put us at. Everything we do is going to have some negative effect.
A lot of teams started during the first round looking at their own countries. But the situation got so dire that they were forced into bilateral and even trilateral negotiations and meetings.
We created a new global coalition on agricultural technology. We got every party who joined it to agree to double their research and development budget, and we were able to get all the other major parties to agree to a price on carbon and then to immediately start moving towards trading.
As the momentums build up, there's more of a sense of countries stepping up to support other countries. If that could be the new normal, it would really be a game changer.
Scientists report that 2028 and 2029 are two of the hottest years on record, and they serve as reminders of the degrading impact of higher temperatures on food production.
The game designers threw a very difficult scenario at us in the last round with multiple crashes and disturbances all over the world. We organized an impromptu global summit trying to deal with those kinds of crises, recognizing that they were only going to get worse.
The point of this meeting is to discuss whether or not we can come up with a response to the growing frequency of climate-driven crises around the world.
We are going to have a pretty hard world to live in. So I propose an organization for response to disaster and emergency relief.
There might be the possibility of the formation of peacekeeping-like forces.
The United Nations could articulate some common standards for things such as logistics planning, for communications, so that when these forces come together in crises, the ability to interoperate has already been predetermined.
The final consequence of the game was to bring together all the countries and all the multilateral institutions and really establish a new environment of global governance.
The world needs stronger cooperation to meet the challenges that the future will throw at it.
In the last couple days, we've learned that alone we can't do it, but together we have all the confidence that this is a problem that we can solve.
International cooperation on these kinds of issues is much more possible than people might think. There is a wide diversity of opinions in all countries. And therefore, there are always like-minded people with whom you can start the conversation.
I have learned how difficult it is to really think out of the box, to imagine something really new. It is so easy to fall back to the old recipes, to be innovative. It wasn't that easy as I thought.
I think I've learned about institutional inertia. How much of a crisis do we need to unlock some of that inertia so that people say, that's not going to work anymore. We have to try something radically different.
The new normal is volatility.
The end of the game indicated a world with greater swings that are closer together, that require attention on a more regular basis.
The world at the end of this game looks pretty dire, but now we can look backwards from 2030 to today, and we can look at that 15-year time span that lies ahead of us and figure out strategies of getting an early start in addressing these issues.
The world can get it right. The simulation showed us that we really need to get ahead of the curve.
Keep working on these ideas and expanding them. Talk about this exercise and the lessons you learned from it. I hope this is the beginning of a great global food security network focused on solving the most important security challenge in the years ahead.
Into the game. Now we'd like to take this opportunity to explain how we created the game and what we learned from it. So a game that's not a game. Games in general serve as a realistic testbed for serious decisions and actions wherein players are allowed to represent broad and relevant interests, which mitigates groupthink issues that can occur with any single entity. They also allow players to realize potential challenges associated with asymmetric information and uncertainty. And allow them to apply tested approaches and lessons learned and develop new solutions against the backdrop of potential consequences. Finally, games allow them to gain insight into each other's actions and reactions, leading to innovative collaborations that ultimately may prove more effective than the actions of any single player. So how does this relate to the future of global food security? Well, since 2005, the world has experienced two major food crises. Price spikes during the 2007 and 2008 food crisis prompted dozens of nations to request emergency food aid, which prompted export restrictions and panic buying and contributed to civil unrest in more than 60 developing countries. The same stress gave rise to food riots, which threatened stability across Africa, the Middle East, Asia, Latin America, and the Caribbean. Researchers have attributed past food crises to the rare confluence of several factors, such as the combined effect of droughts in major grain producing regions, government policy decisions, including things like biofuels policies, and economic conditions. Looking ahead, however, population growth and changing consumption patterns, particularly in developing nations, will require significant increases in agricultural production, despite a shrinking rural labor force, limited availability of new farmland, growing water stress, and increasing risk from climate change. These stresses will likely increase the risk of future global food crises if actions aren't taken now. Past crises and the threat of future ones underscore the need to better understand the global food system, including the stabilizing or destabilizing effect of individual country decisions and the growing impact of climate change. Roughly 8 years ago, the world saw a surge in food prices that pushed more than 100 million people into food insecurity. Governments reacted by introducing various policy measures, sometimes without fully considering how their decisions transferred to food insecurity in the rest of the world. The question of how best to address a large-scale disruption to the global food system, particularly against a backdrop of stressors such as climate change, population growth, energy needs, and water demand. This prompted the sponsors to partner up and organize a game that explores how governments, institutions, and the private sector might interact in this situation. The sponsor's overall goal was to help high-level decision makers across both the public and private spheres better understand the interconnectedness of the global food system, and to use the knowledge generated from the game to ultimately reduce future global food security risks. So how did we get from this goal to the simulation that we ultimately developed? So a little bit about the details of the game and how we achieved this goal by developing Food Chain Reaction. So Food Chain Reaction was a game in which participants took on the role of high-level policy and decision makers who were confronted with and had to react to a global crisis scenario involving disruptions to the global food system. The two-day-long game was held in November of 2015 in Washington, D.C. The 65 carefully selected players were organized into 8 teams representing Brazil, China, the European Union, India, the United States, continental Africa, businesses and investors, and multilateral institutions. During 4 rounds of gameplay spanning 2020 to 2030, teams responded to, prepared for, and managed volatile swings in food supplies and prices, severe weather events, the spread of plant pathogens, supply chain disruptions, migration surges, social unrest, and humanitarian crises. So now I'm going to share a little bit about how we design and develop food chain reaction and then describe the end product. So game design in context. It's really important to recognize that game sponsors have major equities tied to the games that they sponsor. For example, Food Chain Reaction was part of the celebration of Cargill's 150th anniversary. Moreover, World Wildlife Fund saw the game as an important opportunity to raise public awareness that its portfolio of activities went beyond just wildlife conservation. Both World Wildlife Fund and the Center for American Progress strategically timed game conduct so that the game findings might serve as a possible influencer of the December 2015 UN climate talks in Paris. In addition, both organizations saw the game's findings as a springboard to launch additional efforts in food security and sustainable agriculture. As a result, the game design was only a small part of a much larger effort that included such functions as fundraising, player selection, and media outreach, each of which needed to be informed in some way by what was occurring in the game design. In the end, on a cost basis, the game design and development ended up only being roughly 20% of the overall amount required to bring Food Chain Reaction to life. So the question is, how did we get there? What was our approach? We began by designing the game more than 10 months before actual play occurred. As a first step, we identified several overarching objectives to guide game design, followed by the identification of about a dozen more detailed learning goals from which to build the scenario. Over several months, and with the input of a core group of planners representing the sponsoring organizations, and through in-depth research on the determinants of past food crisis and in consultation with numerous subject matter experts across a wide range of disciplines, we developed the game concept and scenario. Early on, we recognized that if players were to be given the freedom necessary to develop innovative and out-of-the-box strategies and agreements, it would not be possible to use quantitative models that could accurately account for all of the possible player decisions. Instead, we designed the game with a human simulation cell, known as the adjudication cell, which comprised numerous members with subject matter expertise in a wide range of disciplines and who adjudicated the collective outcomes of teams' decisions and actions during the game. A few months prior to the game, we conducted a test version with subject matter experts. The test allowed us to gather the information necessary to validate and, where necessary, refine our baseline scenario and game mechanics, including the use of the adjudication cell. Prior to game conduct, players received background information relevant to each team's unique geographic and climatic situation, national security issues, and economic and political status. So, although the game's design was centered on its objectives and its learning goals, it was equally important to have a strong understanding of who would be playing in the game. In other words, the targeted level and range of discussion had to match the expertise and experience of the players. Even after we had reaffirmed who we wanted for the game, finding players was a major effort during the game design process. So now we're going to talk a little bit about the structural elements that actually were the foundation for the game. So while the results of each round were influenced by and ultimately depended on player decisions, each round did have an initial position on the amount of stress that would be introduced due to incidents such as weather phenomena. Players' decisions were used to modify certain recurring signal points built into the game. So how did this all come together on the day of the game? Well, facilitation was a big part of that. So in addition to the significant efforts with respect to player identification and game design, we also had to recruit more than 30 staff members to support gameplay each day. Senior controllers worked in coordination with the game directors to monitor game progress and troubleshoot any challenges or questions that arose. to collect data for the post-game analysis, Scribes reported all of the within-team discussion as well as all of the cross-team negotiation and collaboration. The human adjudication cell, which resolved the decisions made by the teams and determined the new state of the world for each of the rounds 2 through 4, included 7 individuals with significant subject matter expertise across 6 key topic areas. So, at the end of the day, what we ended up with was food chain reaction. Through the design process, we developed a game that spanned a decade and progressed dynamically over 4 rounds of play. Ultimately, the baseline scenario served as a point of departure for gameplay. The scenario included events and conditions, mainly weather and crop production fluctuations, spanning 2020 to 2030. A majority of the baseline scenario elements were exogenous. In other words, the baseline scenario did not include policy-based decisions and actions of playing entities. The choice of exogenous components was deliberate and intended to promote policy actions organic to the game and not prompted by policies in the baseline scenario. Teams were afforded the ability to employ national, bilateral, and/or broadly cooperative approaches to addressing the world's growing food security challenges. Based on team actions and external stresses, the adjudication cell relied on qualitative and quantitative judgment to update the state of the world and illustrate for players the results of their combined actions. The game allowed players to face crises and simulate a response from their teams in a risk-free setting that promoted candid debate on the trade-offs of potential policies, while also providing an opportunity for teams to test possible national, bilateral, and broadly cooperative approaches. At the same time, because events in the later rounds depended on earlier team decisions, the game promoted active ownership of the consequences of players' decisions. The game's relatively open and dynamic format was well suited to explore an issue as complex as food security, which is tied not only to agricultural production, but also diplomacy, security, the environment, economics, and development. Also, the format encouraged players to interact with and learn from other players and teams. And as a result, players expanded their knowledge of possible solutions and drivers of desired outcomes. Now that we've covered the lead up to and the overview of the game, Franklin's going to describe some of the gameplay dynamics, the post-game analytical findings, and the policy recommendations associated with the findings.
Thank you, Kate. So the dynamism and interaction that Kate has described are evidenced by the actions and reactions over the course of the game. The sequence of events throughout the 4 rounds of play developed from a mix of baseline scenarios, player decisions, adjudication results, and injected disruptions. The game flowed from a period of mounting global food system pressure in round 1 to a period of acute crisis characterized by record high food prices, record low food stock levels, and increasing social tension in round 2. In round 3, global pressures from weather and other factors eased, allowing for a period of relative calm. In the final round of play, round 4, players once again encountered increasing global pressures on food prices, food stocks, the environment, and regional stability. Team moves throughout the game included actions like a meat tax to discourage livestock production in the European Union, a coal tax in India, and a carbon tax in the United States. Some of these were later repealed as stocks were replenished and markets stabilized. A buildup of social unrest and migration exacerbated by climate change inspired players to collaborate more closely as a group and with the United Nations to ultimately create new ways of combating insecurity. Some of the primary findings that we want to share with you are listed above. There were stagnant moments throughout the game, reactive moments, and also proactive decision making. But while there was some progress, plenty of regions remained under deep environmental, economic, and social pressures. We found that institutional inertia pervades until political, social, economic, and climatic crises peak. No one nation, business, or organization can adequately address global food security in and of themselves. Information on food security drivers and indicators is lacking in both availability and coverage, and often in the places that need it the most. Instability and volatility are the new normal, and both are inevitably linked to food security. And finally, ensuring food security requires a number of approaches, improvements, and solutions, including those you see listed, such as climate-smart agriculture, better collaboration and governance globally, long-term investments in agricultural research and development, as well as new information sharing systems. From the findings I just described, we distilled a set of policy recommendations focused on closing 3 critical gaps to create a more resilient, food-secure future: a knowledge gap, a productivity gap, and a collaboration gap. To address the knowledge gap, we should develop a real-time global food security dashboard that allows public and private sector decision makers to detect and address disruptions to the global food system before they occur. This data should be collected and maintained in a transparent manner by a trusted global agent. Addressing the productivity gap includes increasing agricultural productivity in low-income countries in a sustainable manner while minimizing its impact on the environment. This will require public, private, and multilateral investments. And those investments must be focused in research, improved farm inputs, expanded extension services, and in the physical infrastructure needed to more efficiently store and move food from production to demand areas. We can close the collaboration gap by creating specialized forums to enable better decision-making in times of crisis, to introduce long-term measures and engage public and private decision-makers on global food security issues. In the words of Mr. Tom Daschle, former senator and food chain reaction supporter, achieving global food and nutrition security is not a game we can afford to lose. While there is no silver bullet and simulations cannot provide exact predictions of what the future holds, they can give us indications of how decision-making takes place in the public and private sectors, so we can apply learnings to improve future outcomes. In the case of food chain reaction, players experience firsthand how their decisions and actions influence global food security. At the conclusion of the game, players highlighted significant lessons learned and expressed increased preparedness to collaboratively address political, economic, and climatic uncertainty. For more information about food chain reaction and to download a copy of our findings and recommendations as well as our technical report, please visit www.foodchainreaction.org. And thank you very much for allowing us to share our experiences as part of this panel.
So we hope that you enjoyed that brief window into the game. Now we'd like to take this opportunity to explain how we created the game and what we learned from it. So a game that's not a game. Games in general serve as a realistic testbed for serious decisions and actions, wherein players are allowed to represent broad and relevant interests, which mitigates groupthink issues that can occur with any single entity. They also allow players to realize potential challenges associated with asymmetric information and uncertainty, and allow them to apply tested approaches and lessons learned and develop new solutions against the backdrop of potential consequences. Finally, games allow them to gain insight into each other's actions and reactions, leading to innovative collaborations that ultimately may prove more effective than the actions of any single player. So how does this relate to the future of global food security? Well, since 2005, the world has experienced two major food crises. Price spikes during the 2007 and 2008 food crisis prompted dozens of nations to request emergency food aid, which prompted export restrictions and panic buying and contributed to civil unrest in more than 60 developing countries. The same stress gave rise to food riots, which threatened stability across Africa, the Middle East, Asia, Latin America, and the Caribbean. Researchers have attributed past food crises to the rare confluence of several factors, such as the combined effect of droughts in major grain-producing regions, government policy decisions, including things like biofuels policies, and economic conditions. Looking ahead, however, population growth and changing consumption patterns, particularly in developing nations, will require significant increases in agricultural production, despite a shrinking rural labor force, limited availability of new farmland, growing water stress, and increasing risk from climate change. These stresses will likely increase.
Hello, yes, we're here.
We'll get back.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah,
okay. Professor Y.K. Alag, former minister, former chairman of IFA, Chancellor CUG, Professor Emeritus Siddharth Patel, Institute of Economic and Social Research in Ahmedabad, and of course, one of our leading economic thinkers, particularly in the space of agriculture and food policy. Mr. Shyam Khadka, FAO representative in India. Professor R.D. Singh, Chancellor CIU and Vice President in AAS. Dr. Partha Mukhopadhyay, and I think some of our other panelists will. We have Balkrishnanand, General Manager, Goska, South Asia, Cargill, and we are have been joined in Washington, D.C. by Holly Franklin of WWF and Mary Kate Fisher of CNA. So welcome to this seminar on using multi-stakeholder simulations to examine the impacts of food policy choices in India and Asia. Typically, the projections of future scenarios of global of the global agriculture and food production situation and what of course the assumption of perfectly competitive markets does is that under the given assumption it leads to unique solutions, and in particular what it cannot really do is actually point to disruptive changes, like, you know, for example, it cannot similarities. And of course, over the years, what has happened is that in various contexts, and I'm aware that this has been done in the context of international trade, that there has been a move away from the use of these kind of models based ultimately on perfectly competitive markets into game theoretic, you know, simulations. And of course, as we have seen that, you know, in the video presentation, that clearly it points the outcomes of this game are, you know, represent certain kinds of turning points, certain kinds of similarities, fall of governments in Pakistan, Ukraine, Bangladesh. I don't know what these governments might think of it, when their game is presented to them. Food riots breaking out, environmental standards being relaxed, and so on. But the primary benefit of a game theoretic approach is that it points in the direction of discontinuities. Now, that is not to say that these are necessarily the discontinuities that will happen. These are not forecasts. These are projections based on certain scenario assumptions. And even for a given scenario, that a game theoretic approach, well, it can lead to multiple solutions. So the point, of course, is that, you know, once you have multiple solutions, it does not follow that necessarily an event like fall of governments in Pakistan or Bangladesh is solved. But the point is that playing such games repeatedly gives an insight into the kinds of discontinuities and similarities that might happen. And that's a very, very important aspect to be taken into account, both in terms of national and global policy making. So this workshop is about the use of such games in looking at global food policy. I listened carefully, I came a little late, I listened carefully to the presentation. And of course it seemed to me that there were certain aspects which were not covered in the scenarios. So if we introduce these aspects, we may have, you know, certainly different outcomes. As you could even with the scenarios as happening to the different set of players can have different outcomes. But for example, disruptive technical change. We speak about disruptive technical change all the time in the context of energy. But clearly there are technological possibilities in agriculture which are in the nature of disruptive technologies. For example, technological change which can impart leguminous properties to cereal crops. Well, that's disruptive. Genetic engineering which can lead to highly enhanced drought and saline resistance. That's another kind of technology. That's another kind of disruptive technology. There could also be disruptive policies. For example, the Indian program of intervention of the river, it arouses strong emotions. There are people who are very strongly in favor, there are people who are very strongly against. Both sides have their reasons. But the point is that the implementation of such a program has the effect of a disruptive change in the Indian agricultural scenario. So of course the broad point that I'm making is that it's possible to develop different kinds of scenarios. Each set of scenarios when run through the game can lead to multiple solutions, multiple outcomes over the simulation period. But I think the real value, if I might reiterate, is the fact that it points to disruptive changes, it points to singularities, it points to discontinuities, which I think, you know, they have to be taken into account at both national and international levels. So let me now invite our participants one by one. Our first, our opening bat is Mr. Shyam Khadka, FAO representative in India. He has to leave for another event very soon. He's a man who's much in demand these days. So Mr. Khadka, you have the floor.
Thank you very much for chair and the panelists. Actually, when Nutanji invited me for this, I was really wondering if the presence of such a distinguished panelist I have any role to play. But nevertheless, I think just to share some of my comments as opposed to the conference, I'm really very pleased that this exercise is being done, because the world is increasingly becoming interconnected, the globalization, the specialization of production systems and globalization and trade and everything. The interconnectedness also creates a very high level of interdependency. These two words are very related. And in a very interdependent world, the actors that come into the picture are numerous. In a disinterconnected thing, the number of actors and situations you have to deal with are limited. So the interconnectedness, the number of actors increase very significantly. And the risk also goes up very, very high. And there is huge potentialities that we can capture through the specialization machine and production system, but the risk also is very high. I mean, let me take you back just to give an example of interconnectedness. You know, in 1973, when after the Iran-Israel war, when the oil prices started shooting up 5% every month, and the U.S. administration was under President Jimmy Carter, so he was definitely a worried man, and then so he asked the team to undertake an exercise that if the continent of the United States are to be sealed from everything else, we close the border at every point, and continent of the United States, not outside of it, what will happen? And the simulation exercise of this type was done in the studies. And the finding was that the United States would stand for about 100 days. It could survive for 100 days, and after that, it would be forced to open its border. So that was 1973, when the U.S. was the major manufacturing power at that time. Today, if you run the simulation for U.S., where the manufacturing base has already moved out of the country in a big way, where would it stand? And that was the most powerful country in the most important part of its history. Today, if you run that stimulus exercise for India or countries like China, and then if you really see the scenario, actually no country in the world stands any chance to survive beyond a week if given those dependencies on each other. So this kind of exercise is very important, because that then it shows us, well, you know, sort of how should we cooperate internationally? How should conflicts be resolved? That's the first point I wanted to make. So thank you, Terry, for organizing the thing. In running the simulation, what I was very pleased is that you have really brought the interdisciplinary team of experts into the exercise. And I would like to submit that this actually requires a very diverse kind of sort of specialist to contribute to the exercise. And on that, I would like to make the point that the chair said, is that, you know, we normally bring the economists to make decisions, and let's say, assuming that, well, we apply the theory of comparative advantage and the relative production cost, the relative standing of the countries to produce goods and services, we take that model. And then, of course, there will be a free flow of trade, and all agricultural commodities will pass off each other. So basically, that model will go that route, and the disruption will be much less. But take another scenario where the decision making is not taken only on the pure economic merit. Decision making is taken on political economic merit. Like, you know, in 2007-8, one of the first things that happens is that the export ban is applied. Export ban on rice is applied in India and Pakistan, and many other countries started applying export bans. And that is not an economic decision. We all know that that is a political economic decision. That decision has one root. One fundamental problem in agriculture we cannot forget is any government in the world, if it has to make a choice between a rural-based farmer and an urban consumer, 99 of the 100 times they will take the side of the urban consumer. The political economy of urban, the political power of urban consumers is much more than the rural farmers. So obviously, you know,
The price increase actually would have helped the Indian farmer at that time. But you know, at that time, we do not get the farmer's gain, but we are afraid of urban consumers, and we are, of course, the political decision-making supports them altogether. So these are the realities. One of the things I would like to submit to this panel is that the considerations for decision-making, the criteria for decision-making can be very different from one actor to another actor. The perspectives are very different from one to another. And you know, very lay persons like, you know, I would consider all of us basically lay persons, we have a discipline to follow, and we think that decision-making will take this route, and we decide on that basis. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen. The incentives for the decision makers are very different from, you know, what you think is an incentive for me to decide is very different to the Agriculture Minister of India. So so these are my submissions. Basically, I'm trying to say that it's important that we bring a very large number of actors into it, and the simplest exercise would allow for that. The one other thing that I saw in the presentation, I'd like to submit what from FAO's perspective in India is, some of the factors missing in food planning is the information on the private stock of the food grains are missing. And then that's one area where I could be working at the moment. This is, you know, in the global food planning, that's always an issue. You know, I'll give you I was born in a mountain farm. And my mother the farm would produce practically everything except for kerosene or some clothes and things like that. And her planning was very simple. She would keep, at the harvest point, she would keep what she would require for the whole year, and one little surplus would be sold. So every farm was actually self-sufficient by itself. So the planning was very simple. Every household is supposedly self-sufficient, and they would plant their buying decision. Today, nobody does that. You know, people are, especially having a soil production system, they sell and they buy themselves over time. Because of those factors, the private stock, the behavior of the private stockholders in the farm have changed over time. And that is one information we lack in actually putting, you know, in estimating what are the food requirements in India or any other country in the world. FAO has been working with the government of India on this kind of thing. We have developed a methodology to estimate the stock kept by the private sector, including the farmers. And we are doing a workshop in November, and I would like to submit to you that what this example I want to bring you is that actually, despite everything, we know a lot of things, but actually we still do not know a lot of things. So we keep that eye open, and my solution is that the knowledge gap, the 3 points that we finally concluded, we still have to deal with the knowledge gap quite significantly in food security planning. That's my final submission here. Thank you very much for giving me at the meeting. It's organized by Terry itself. I'm not choosing Terry versus the other organization. Terry meeting, so I have to go. Thank you so much once again for this opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Khadja. And we hope to keep you in Delhi all day today, and maybe the next couple of days also. And thank you for your presentation. So now,
one of the things is just to sort of reiterate, well, during the food chain day, the food chain reaction is important. To look at the notes, you find that one of the issues that did come was that creation of a global system. And one of the issues in that is precisely what you just said, transparent sharing of information across government and private sector. Because there are individuals, obviously, and that affects with another individual, but there also, I mean, large firms like Cargill, like ABM, like others, would also have stocks. And those are, some part of it is commercially valuable information, and so on and so forth. And the idea was to try and, in the interest of global governance, try and put together some of those information in a common pool. So I'm really glad to see that FAO has been working on that sensibly.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Khadka. I now give the floor to Professor Alan.
Thank you, sir. I have been asked to speak on. I think I've been asked to do it because I was there in this meeting in Washington that has left me with a very dubious privilege of being here today. Although with Project was there, I'm not quite sure whether both of us were necessary. One of us could have done that. the game. I think I'm more interested in methodology, how we go about organizing it rather than outcome, because I think it's early hours yet. And if you organize a game, you should go in with a more or less an open mind, so that, you know, the game itself gives you some returns. So that's the thing I would like to concentrate on, so that it can help Lupin and Terry in organizing this game together with the people in Washington. I think the interesting part is that the FEO rep has gone, but you know, the earlier FEO global models were basically simulation models. I mean, Agriculture Force 2000,
yes.
I'm supposed to be one of its architects, Peter Petrie, me, and a Brit. And that is now Agriculture towards 2050, and the same thing they keep on churning out. But the earlier models were simulation models, and then somewhere near the late 90s, when R.P. Singh was there in Bangkok, environment came in into it in a big way. And so, in a way, those scenarios are changing. People are saying that, and I think you put it very well when you said, well, I'm not sure whether the Agriculture Towards 2000 was a competitive model. It wasn't. You're right, the CTAP models are. This was a simulation model. It was not a general equilibrium model. General equilibrium studies were done on the side, but it wasn't a particular model. But even then, they really didn't get into these kind of very disruptive kinds of behavior, where the normal is actually not equilibrium. And that is, I think, a methodological issue. It's there in almost everything. The chaos as a part of understanding behavior and decision making. I think that's where this is a very helpful way of looking at things. Now, what I did was that I will just describe the game. You've heard descriptions, but I look at it in a slightly different way, and I think that is why Washington keeps on asking me to come on these kinds of meetings. You know, it's about basically about reactions of different stakeholders to what other people are doing, which is a pretty standard game theory setup, although they say that this is not game theory. But I think the purpose is slightly different, which is that when you don't know what is happening, basically you are in a field where there is uncertainty. Then, if you put together people who are involved, in a way, out of darkness, you start creating some light. Because the actors are forced to take a position. And behind that, there is the experience and the information that they have. Now, this is a rather silly thing for a past president of the Indian Econometric Society to say, because it's not equilibrium economics, it's not statistics. But as both the FEO rep and you have said, the world is a more chaotic place. And if you look at it that way, this is methodologically an advance. So you have to think about it in that kind of a perspective. So you have these large countries. The world is changing. Somewhere in the 90s, you cross $3,000 per capita, and grain becomes less important, and non-grains become very important. Why it is $3,000? There have been some explanations, but as a teacher of economics, I find them very unsatisfactory. And if you have a good PhD student, I'll be quite happy to be a co-guide to look into that question. But $3,000 in purchasing power parity prices is the number there. Now, when these things happen, then of course, the kind of thinking that you had in the 70s, which was food security, but largely it was grain and grain stocks. And now you're talking about a different world. So that creates a complication, because all of a sudden from one commodity, you get to a very wide range of commodities. And the actors are all now acting around it. And they are mobile. They move from rural to urban areas. I wrote a book on the future of Indian agriculture. And its big story was that 4 crore farmers have moved from villages to what are called large villages, which the census calls towns, but the Maibab Sarkar, under the influence of people like Dr. Ghosh and Dr. Singh, because they are, have been distinguished civil servants, I'm not a professor. So the census can call
professor too.
I know. But you know, also,
Your primary
yeah, but you know, you have to, then you must criticize this thing. That if the census says that a place is a town, why does the government not call it a town? Why did you not call it a town? You kept on calling it a village, because there is the politics of being a panchayat, we know that. But that creates a lot of confusion when you are doing this kind of stuff. Because the farmer, and in many cases, she is a woman, is actually going to a town. But you don't regard that as a town. So you don't call in the Kargils and tell them, bhai, wahan jao. You see, you create the markets there. You create, in your smart cities, even today, there's not a single one where you have put in electronics for marketing, agricultural marketing. Because you don't even regard these, you don't even regard them as market towns. Where the farmer goes. 4 crore farmers go there. There are 4,000 such towns. But we ignore them for policy. I mean, where are we? When I made a lot of noise, the 12th plan said, there are these census towns, but in the projections, they're still not there. Anyway, now we don't have planning, so all that has been solved. But the point is, yeah, but they're not getting into this problem. See, because this needs a long-term perspective, and things are connected together. That's why you need some form of strategic planning, okay? Don't provoke me, because I might take an hour on that. So now what is happening is that different actors look at this very complex problem. And where there is darkness, you start seeing some light. It's a beginning, but I think methodologically we are moving away, and Chair, you put it very well, we are moving away not just from pure competition. I mean, I think...
It was rubbish to start with.
Well, yeah, but you know, by now, I mean, those days it was okay when we were there. I mean, a kid had to collect a lot of data, usse PhD mil jata tha. Ab to kya, I mean, 15 minute mein solve ho jata problem with Google, so what do you need equilibrium models for of that kind? You just put, they are not even good enough to get your degree anymore. But the point here is that it is this chaos which the game theory is trying to create a certain degree of light where there is darkness. And in this little note I said, well, you can use it for Kavari. You know, the Supreme Court has again said, let some experts go. They had said it in 1996 as the Prime Minister had asked me to go. But apart from saying that Karnataka should release so much of water, I argue that you should set up the Kaveri, the Mekong system, which is that you have first technical people, then you have political people, and at the top level you have the Prime Minister and the Chief Ministers. In the Mekong, they were what was called Vice Premiers, from countries which are going to war with each other. And they never, after that, the Mekong problem was never one which created violence. And also in Kaveri, this is the first year where after 15 years we are having violence. Otherwise there was a lot of tension. But once this method was there, this is the first time, because the PM didn't take the meeting, the Water Resources Minister did, and these fellows have walked out. You know, it's a sort of going back, because with the Prime Minister there, they dare not agree when they are accosted with whatever is the information. So this kind of a setup where you bring people together you make them in areas where there is uncertainty, put their cards on the table, is methodologically, I think, an advance on the earlier simulation models that we have, or the equilibrium models that we have, because the world is chaotic. Now, having said this, the only other point that I wanted to make was that I think a lot of what we've heard from the morning is not going to be relevant for Asia. And I'm glad that you got RB Singh here. Because we have big countries, India, China, Indonesia, Thailand, Vietnam, Philippines, and we are poorer countries, and we have a lot of inequality within. And our food security problem is related to that. We don't have excess stocks. I mean, you know, I was a little cautious, but you know, I was supposed to be there. Reason that I don't understand, they elected me as a leader of our delegation. But they kept around promising that India will give away stocks. I said, hey, please, there are thoda. India will give away stocks. Abhi nahi hai, bahut sare gareeb log bhi baithe hain. So, the point is that when you get into Asia, you are talking A, about the world within the world. The FAO rep is gone. Every major agro-climatic region of the world is there within the large Asian countries. In India, in Vietnam, in Thailand, in Indonesia, of course. So you are in a very different world. And even in a country like Vietnam, which is relatively smaller, please remember that about 10 years ago, and I've given all those references, I mean, a lot of problems arose because of the difficulty between the valley and the hills. The people in the hills are much poorer, and they create problems. They stop carts going from the valley to the hill. So, if you are going to play simulation games, I think in the large Asian countries, I don't think you can do it in China, but most certainly in India, now Myanmar, which very little was known earlier, most certainly Thailand has always had that experience. We always think about Bangkok and what is the other place, Pattaya, but Thailand is a very different country altogether. I mean, one of my friends is a professor there, and he takes me around. So, you know, if you get into Asia, you can, I think this part, that there is diversity, that there is agro-climatic diversity, that large Asian countries are worlds within the world, and that there is inequality, has to be a part of the games that you will play. And I think those will be very different kinds of games. And I've given some references to show that the great problem that the FAO and others have studied in this is in that. So these are my comments. Thank you very much.
Mr. Zen?
Yeah.
So, Professor Allah, thank you very much for your insightful and always very stimulating remarks. And I'm sure that in the discussion session, you will be actually bombarded with comments and questions, and that's okay.
Hello, thank
you.
Hello?
Hello?
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So you are connected?
We are.
Okay,
yeah.
Good.
Okay, great. Thank you. Yeah, so now let me give the floor to Professor R.D. Singh. So, Professor Singh.
And that is where I had the opportunity. But then also.
But ICR, because you are a big establishment.
Sir, I was the director of the
ICR. ICR is still a part of the collector and the
institute.
Rather than the
most
university.
Important assignment, which I think was important for me in India. Was particularly as a member of the National Commission on Farmers. That I thought was very very fruitful for me to educate me to really with the grassroots reality, besides myself being son of a farmer.
Very distinguished academic.
I think.
I should have said, the present company is excluded.
Coming back to having seen the global being based in Rome also for 5 years, also seeing the global situation and India home, India is not any other country. It is to be seen differently. It's a game changer, as a matter of fact. And what happens in India will underpin what will happen at the global level, as a matter of fact. Today, we have 1/4 of the world's hungry in India, 40% of the world's children who are undernourished are our own children. The amount of economic loss that stunted children bring to so-called tall India is something paradoxical. We have to see the cost. The total cost of this kind of undernutrition, food insecurity, which our country suffers today because of this continuing, unethically, critically high degree of undernutrition in our country. So India, among many things, we are today number one or number two or number three in the production of major commodities. We are number one in the whole world today in milk production. We are number one in vegetable production. We are number two in fruits production. We are number three in wheat and rice production in the whole world. If you look at the growth during the last 10 years, amazing. And India underpins then what is being produced globally as well as locally. So I will connect that India has to be seen differently. It influences the world as a whole. And therefore, I would like to connect myself local with global. If you take India and the globe as a whole, the local and global, even a household in India, anywhere in any corner, whether you take Bihar or Karnataka, anywhere in remote place, they are all interconnected. So local and global are mutually interdependent, interconnected, and this is the view of the total United Nations, the FAO, and this is why, as a matter of fact, today, I was in touch with the Director General of FAO. He was emphasizing he will be coming to India. We'll be having the opportunity also to see that he influences the thinking process in our own country of getting truly an international movement arising out of the Indian, and the workshop which Shyam Khadga mentioned too will be probably touching upon some of these things. So I will say local and global mutuality, interconnectivity is extremely important. And this is why many of our, if a policy decision is to be taken, many of our state agriculture universities, I happen to be also chancellor of the Central Agriculture University. As a matter of fact, I would like the state agriculture university to be renamed, not a land grant university, but a world grant university. Our universities, because local and global are interconnected, we should be able to see that there is a change in the total attitude how we support our human resource development who will be serving the humanity to get rid of the hunger and poverty and the misery and deprivation. As a matter of fact, we live in such an unequal world of India. If you look at a farmer and non-farmer, today the farmer's income is 1/4. Mind you, farmers at least 50% of the total population of India. Or 650 million or so farmers and farmers' families. If that is the case, 120, 125 million farm families, each family at least of 5 persons, you make it already 650 million people. And these 650 million people have average income, these farm families, 1/4 of those who are non-farmers. So we live in such an unequal India, Bharat and India, as a matter of fact. And if that Bharat comprises of the farmers, as you can see the disparity. So if you talk of the disruptive thinking, the changes that has to be brought into place, and the disruption that has to be brought. Today, those disruptions are realities. And this is why you keep hearing the United Nations coming up with new names, new normals. New normal one, what is new normal one? New normal one is simply saying that food, nutrition, income, health, education, livelihood security, all these things are interlinked and cannot be seen in isolation. And therefore, if any policy decision has to be taken, any game change has to take place, obviously the interlink, the nexus of these five, six major components of life are absolutely essential. So what was something disruptive? What was something so different yesterday? Today, it is new normal. Therefore, when you talk of the simulation models or one or the other kind of different models, please realize where are we today, how things are changing. And this is a change which has taken place in the global thinking, new normal. I will take one more normal and I will stop because I could see we can always have round to come back, hopefully. I have quite a few other points to mention. So I thought this is one change which has to be kept in mind to see that we have the zero generation, zero hunger generation, as the director general of FAO says, zero hunger world, zero hunger generation, which is so very important. Then the second new normal, today we talk of the climate change instability, volatility, you name it, the market instability, volatility, both monsoon and market instability, volatility, which are there, which have become a common thing, and these have been also named as new normal. So climate change is a reality, it's a must, you cannot deny it, and if so, that is a normal thing that is happening. And market fluctuations, market forces, disruptions which they bring about, you know, 2007, 2008 case already, if that is happening, then obviously these had to be internalized in any model, in any change that you want to bring about in your total process of utilizing the best of technology to serve the humanity with human face. If this is where, but then the other disruptions, as it comes to technological disruptions, policy disruptions, and so on and so forth, I would be able to chip into later. But I thought these points I would like to make, which are new normals, are taking cognizance of something which was abnormal, disruptive. But today, we have to assimilate it differently and account for it in our weight that we provide in our modeling to these new developments. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Adi Singh, for your observations, and I do hope that we have the time to come back to our panelists. Our next speaker is Dr. Parth Mukhopadhyay, Senior Fellow in CPR in Delhi. Dr. Mukhopadhyay, thank you.
I'll be brief because I think Alec has covered a lot that we've learned from our experience in Washington. So, one of the issues, as I understand the context of this conversation, is about trying to see whether similar kinds of issues could be raised in regional context here. And one of the core learnings that I personally had from the food chain reaction simulation is essentially the diversity of viewpoints within specific groupings, as we understand. And therefore, the issues that will sort of come up, I mean, for example, recently, in one of the countries in the region, we have had significant unrest related to the fact that particular sections of the population there are not confident that the government of that particular country would serve them adequately. And in that situation, the issue that comes about is if you have a government-to-government kind of interaction, does it actually mitigate the problem? Because when we're doing this simulation in Washington, so we said global food stocks, people coming through, but eventually there was an understanding that if it reached the government of country X, it also reached the people of country X. And that need not be an assumption that will always be maintained. And that's something that we need to sort of keep in mind.
And the way one perhaps keeps that in mind is precisely, I think, to expand on what Professor Allen says, is that we need to, in formulating the groups that we get together for such a game, we need to be pay careful attention to the kinds of representatives that we have that comprise different groupings within that particular game. And that sort of might make some differences. In some cases, we sort of anticipate some of them, in others, we sort of unable to do so in different ways. So that's one of the issues that I think will sort of comes through in terms of game design. And the second kind of issue that will perhaps come through in game design is the structure that sort of came through during the Washington simulation was there was always a nice, neat fallback option. The neat fallback option was that we could go towards global governance. And global governance, in a sense, was that, you know, the UN is still yet an organization around which, if people want to get together, they can get together. It doesn't evoke too many negative feelings across a large number of countries. In a regional situation, to be able to create such a focal point organization, we recently had an issue with the one regional institution that we have. So there isn't really, whereas in Washington, we did have global governance kind of issues to fall back on. Here, was not quite sure what would our regional solution be like? Where would it be located? How structured? All of that stuff. So it's so that would add an additional degree of complication. The kind of option, realistic option that people would sort of come up with when they are working through this problem, and the game controllers, therefore, the kind of options and structures that sort of curveballs to throw into the area. And there will also be, and finally, the third point I would like to make is one of the issues that I think does come out even in places like India, and I'm sure it will come out elsewhere also, which was finessed during the Washington Games, is the actual nitty-gritty of logistics. I mean, actually getting bulk commodities such as food out of place X and into place Y requires levels of infrastructure, which especially in this particular region are not all that well developed, especially in terms of ports, shipping, coastal shipping structures, all of that space. Therefore, when we, and the reason I sort of bring that in is that essentially again to say that when we are bringing the stakeholders in that area, I'm sure that if you have commercial firms, they will bring some of that perspective. It would be useful to perhaps get some of the regional logistics players into the room to get a sense as to where, how feasible is it to get grain out of port X in India, into port Y in Myanmar, or vice versa. So that's the, these are the three things at the moment that we put on the table.
What within a city? Minority groups are left out.
The degrees of official quote unquote neglect can be at different scales. In a number of our cities are countryside cities. Delhi is 20 million
people. Ghettos.
So there would be issues in that. Local delivery issues.
Thank you, Dr. Bartha, for giving us, in a sense, a blow-by-blow account of what happened in Washington. And of course, I mean, you know, in a sense, you reinforce my intuition that that actually the specific outcomes of a given simulation of a given game depends very much on the players that players who are actually involved. And of course, I think the value of these kinds of games would really be if certain kinds of disruptive outcomes were to be repeated consistently across players from, you know, from different backgrounds. I think that would be a, that would really send strong, very strong signal that yes, I mean, these are you know, disruptive events that we can that we have to you know, that we have to watch out for. I actually find the faith of the Washington participants in the credibility and indeed the capability of the UN system rather touching, having been a negotiator for many years in one of the processes under the UN system. But however, I think, you know, that
I don't think it was good to be fair to the participants there. I think the story was, if you want to make it work, you can make the UN work. Most of the time the UN doesn't work because there isn't consensus that you want it to work. So I think the prior is an important prior. In this case, if there is the intent, then in some sense there's an instrument. That is the, that's only nuance I'll put in. Instrument without the intent, absolutely.
Well, it looks from what you're saying is that the majority of the participants would have been economists, who are happy to assume things.
This looks
typically like an economic story of assume a can opener. So let me now invite Mr. Balakrishnan Anand, General Manager Gosca South Asia Kargil. So Sana, the floor.
Chair and distinguished panelists. Disclaimer first, I'm here to learn. So I actually learned a lot, you know, in the last hour and 30 minutes. Kargil also takes a lot of pride in being one of the major stakeholders, you know, of this game in Washington. And we dedicate, you know, our commitment, you know, to such kind of efforts in Washington and in other parts of the world, you know, as we go forward and go on. So with that, I think I would refer to one of the chart, you know, which was shown into the game that has shown, you know, from 2020 to 2030, and like everybody said that, you know, it is the game theory is more around the disruptions. So the government's following geopolitics, climate, etc. You know, those disruptions, you know, we cannot call out, and therefore, you know, we cannot have ready-made plan in the offing, you know, whenever they happen. So I think the world has to respond, you know, as and when they come. But around that, you know, I think there's another message, you know, that this theory, you know, is throwing, is that there is a reality, and that will also be a new normal. I don't know, 1, 2, 3, or 4,
yeah.
But
yeah.
It will be a new normal.
Yeah.
That world is going to be 9 billion people, for sure. Right? So the population growth is on the card. Now that happens, you know, in the next 10 years, 20 years, or 30 years, you know, we will see. But it is going to happen. With the 7.2 already, we are going to go to 9 billion. With or without the disruptions, I think let's accept that, you know, we would need, you know, more food. And one of the speakers mentioned that the food is not now the grain and the cereals, which is the calorie-based food. I think the nature of the food will also change, or has changed to a large extent, wherein, you know, we will say the calorie plus the nutrition, right? So the nutrition is, fortunately or unfortunately, is again coming, you know, from the cereal, because we feed, you know, the grains, you know, to the cattle, and therefore, you know, we have the animal protein in the form of the milk or the meat or whatever, right? So we are going to put a lot of stress, you know, onto our land resources, water, energy, and therefore, you know, the climate. So one big ticket, you know, is this, that the climate. So with this preamble, you know, if we say that, you know, are we already at a stage where we are panic stricken? I don't think so. That's the case today. You know, today we have plenty of calories available in the world. If we look at the situation today, and I look at the prices in the Chicago, which is the benchmark, you know, reference for the worldwide prices, we are at the record low, so far as the grains or the cereal crops are concerned. So there is a production response, there's a plenty of calories, but then, you know, at the same time, you know, we have a lot of hungry people, maybe a billion plus people, you know, across the world. So I think it is, you know, to do with the distribution of the food, you know, wherever it is needed, so that it reaches, that, you know, ties up, you know, with the point of Mr. Partha said that about the logistics, whether it is bulk or, you know, moving the food, you know, from the surpluses, you know, to wherever it is needed. I think we need to do a very good job of that. Second part is that, you know, we talk about the food festivals. You know, this is linked, you know, with the green gases emission, you know, which if we waste, and therefore, you know, we need to put, you know, more stress on the producing mode, you know, to feed the demand. Instead of that, you know, if we are able to control the wastages, and, you know, therefore, you know, the need of producing more can be postponed, you know, temporarily, you know, to an extent. I think that is another area, you know, we need to look at that, you know, how do we work on the supply chain to make it more robust, that, you know, where the wastages can be controlled. Coming down, you know, from this larger perspective, you know, into the South Asian region, where, you know, we are all talking and remember this subject in which the dairy has also proposed, is this that, you know, when I look at the South Asian region, I feel that if we talk about the 9 billion population increase, the largest part of the population increase actually is going to come into the more weather vulnerable countries. That's the reality. It is Africa, it is, you know, the South Asian countries, including India, right? So for us, the need of, you know, addressing this food and the nutritional security is far greater, you know, than the rest of the world. That is number one. But then there's another side of the reality, which is obviously that, you know, our per capita consumption of the calorie and the nutrition is probably lowest, right? Or amongst the lowest, you know, in the world. So we have to bridge this gap. We have to produce more, right, to, you know, feed, or, you know, maybe to bring our per capita consumption of calorie and nutrition, you know, to the world levels. So this puts, you know, the stress on more availability or the better food availability, you know, which is food safe and sustainable as well. So if we look into this context and therefore we see that, you know, how can we address it? I think, you know, Dr. R.B. Singh has mentioned that in the last 10, 20 years, India has responded fantabulously well in terms of the production response. So we have temporarily outpaced, you know, the demand, you know, with the supply of what we have been producing. And India has been exporting a lot of food actually out of it. So this, you know, was all possible with the help of the natural resources, you know, we have in the country. And we were able to produce, you know, whatever we were able to produce. Now, the natural resources, you know, are limited. And probably the land is the first one where we are reaching, you know, to a stage which is not available in plenty mode. So, and the climate, you know, changes, if we, you know, plug the whole thing, you know, with that together, I think the vulnerability in our production, the new normal number 7 or 8, you know, will be that, you know, the normalized weather risk in a country like India, which is a world in the world itself, is going to be, you know, much larger. So how do we address it? I think the need of technology, the research, and the science is, you know, going to be much more needed as, you know, it was in the past. So normally, you know, we see in many other industries, what we have seen in the last 30 years, last 50 years, last, you know, 20 years, we are going to see probably that in the next 5 years. The agriculture is also going to see that, but more, you know, to the demand side than, you know, to the supply side. So if we want to have the supply response also coming, matching with the demand, I think, you know, there's a greater need, you know, to invest into the science and technology now, whether it is the better seed or even better irrigation facility, which is suited, you know, to the kind of agroclimatic zones what we have, the farm, you know, average farm holding size what we have, and the number of people engaged into this farming community. So I think, you know, this is what we need to do. So if we put the whole thing together from here on, the decisions or the policy making, whether it is, you know, the advocacy at the world level through these games, or the advocacy, you know, at the regional level through these regional organizations, or the advocacy, you know, within the country or a particular country, you know, at the government level, the choices from here are not very popular. You know, they're difficult ones. So I think the time is there, you know, when we build the consensus and, you know, whatever we discuss, we talk, we, you know, bring it, you know, to a state where we can, you know, with the help of the organizations like Dairy, etc., can put it forward, you know, for the next level of discussions and the solutions will come out of that. With that, you know, I think I will pass my opinion. Thank you.
Can you see business playing a bigger role in this?
Sure.
Means other people will come, sure, apart from country.
Other people also. Other people as well. We talk about it.
These are crises too good to waste.
So I take that as a compliment.
where would we be without, you know, corporates actually taking advantage of addressing possible crises. So let me now, you know, bring in Holly Franklin and Kate Fisher, you know, to participate, you know, with their observations. So the floor is given to the two of you.
He's not here. Because
are you there?
Yeah.
Because Rahul was there.
Yeah, we're here.
Yeah, yeah. So the floor is given to both of you.
Great, thank you. And I think in the interest, I was just going to say real quickly, because in the interest of time, I know that we're running up against a hard stop on the panel, but I would say from a game design perspective, particularly in the regional context, that the discussion today is a fascinating, and I think there's some real opportunity there to look at some of these issues of regional governance, particularly in areas of relatively high vulnerability that are expected to encounter increased vulnerability moving forward. And these issues that have been brought up, not only governance, but also infrastructure, for example, are certainly kind of prime areas for using gaming as a mechanism for trying to really understand how the given stakeholders would react in a crisis situation with things like infrastructure constraints or regional government constraints. And so I'm really excited actually to hear all of the discussion today, which is my high level takeaway from hearing all the panelists.
Right. Mr. Franklin?
Mrs.
Franklin, sorry, I'm sorry about that.
Thank you. No problem. Thank you. I would just echo what Kate said. I think, this has been just tremendously fascinating discussion. And I think the for WWF, where this gets really interesting is to take things like the logistics, the infrastructure, and some of the regional natural resource and population challenges, and then overlay that with climate uncertainty. And, thinking about this idea of all of these new normals, is definitely a connector from, some of the outcomes we saw from the first game going forward. So just tremendously fascinating. I think most of our comments were in our prepared remarks earlier, and we're just excited to hear the remarks from other folks for the remainder of the time.
Thank you, Professor.
I wanted to sort of at this stage bring to the attention of our friends in Washington that what these discussions are showing is that the so-called normal is very different in Asia as compared to what we saw in Washington. We are land scarce and water scarce countries, many of us. There is a lot of inequality. There are these governance questions. So, it's not just the infrastructure. I mean, the actors will have to be very different. They will also have to be the guys out, in Vietnam, as I said, you have to talk about the people, not only in the valleys, but in the hills. In my own hometown, we'll have to talk about people in the ghettos who don't get food, even though there's a lot of food going around. So there will be these kind of questions. Poverty levels in Asia are much higher as compared to these kind of problems have been virtually resolved in the large parts of the world, which we saw in Washington. Poverty is a sense of malnutrition. So there will be these kinds of questions. Because you don't have this one, you have plenty of water. I mean, your water availability per person is at least five times ours. And India and China have already crossed the Falcon Mark Index. And Dr. Ghosh is an expert on these things. Land also is, we have good land, but it's scarce now. Technology is the big mantra, and yet technology is not something out there, as man matters there. So there will be a different context, that's all that I wanted to say. And when you plan these things, you'll have to worry about that.
Thank you, Professor Alak, and I think the main, one of the themes that has really emerged is that the new normals. And I take it that by new normals we mean not only a shifting of the mean, but also increased variance.
Sure.
That's what we're talking about. So, what would you like to come in on?
No. I think Mr. Harvey Singh wanted to
reflect on something. Just a second. True, South Asia particularly, Asia as a whole, South Asia in particular, is very different, like India. Therefore, some region specificity has to be kept in mind as we go along in the process. So this is the very initial capital of what we say of deprivation that we have in this region is amazingly too high. And two, the technology fatigue. I would mention that we must change agriculture as a whole to make it look as if from STEM to STEAM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, put A in between, make it STEAM, A in between, so that agriculture becomes much more science-led growth, and for that we need investment. We need a different way of doing it. Invested via technology products, our GM products and so on and so forth, by security concerns or policy is dragging feet. We have not been able to clear many of these developments and products in process, and we have denied ourselves of the right opportunities to be taken to help those who need the help. Therefore, I think a comprehensive picture in terms of sharing technology and new products, and developing new technology, the genome editing is so very important today. You mentioned about how the abiotic and biotic stresses could be handled through the genetic alchemy, and that those genetic alchemy, the genomic editing, and so on, new approaches, these don't have the same danger as we used to have the transgenics. But we have not moved ahead. We are still jumping at the same place. So we cannot really gain land, gain ground in the process. So I think we have to change in policy matters, implementation, governance, clearance of many of those things are much more important today. I think that is a very important thing to change the game, to make a difference, and that is not happening.
Right. Thank you, Professor R.B. Singh. Now let me throw the floor open to the participants, and I see Mr. Patnaik.
Yeah, I think there's no doubt that the three conclusions that were reached in the game, knowledge gap, productivity gap, and
collaboration
gap, these are very important. I think I agree with Professor Alad that in India we have to look at it in a slightly different way. Many cases, we are not in the same situation as Washington is. And there's a huge inequality in our own system, within our own house also, there are large inequalities. I think the biggest is the policy gap, apart from the other three gaps, policy gap and policy induced inequalities, I would say. And what Mr. Balanan said, apart from the demand, the distribution inequality is what really is very, very acute in India. We have the production, today we are producing more fruits and vegetables than grains. We are number one and about the same set in many things. But our distribution system is totally skewed in favor of some people. Unfortunately, the APMC Act, which was originally designed to help the farmers get a good value, is today doing exactly the opposite. It's helping the traders to cartelize and keeping things low. And it's well recognized, yet we are not able to do anything about it. For the last 15 years, we've been trying to correct it. Farmers Commission, we try to remove the boundaries between states, within the state, between this. We have not been able to do that. The acts like the Essential Commodities Act and the APMC Act really have added to the problems of insecurity, volatility, price volatility in certain regions. We have great amount of volatility within the country because trade is not free. Every time there are restrictions in it. So I think one of the things that we have to look at is making our own policies in line with the requirement that is in the
right.
I agree that other cases also are there. I mean, one of the things I would like to mention here today, although it's not a very not a forward-looking thing, it's here and now. The price inflation on food prices is the biggest challenge today that India is facing. And partly it is induced by wrong taxation policies. We are taxing things at the root level, which are the cascading effects. So when we are moving toward GST, can we think of correcting this pyramid, which will correct the, at least strike at the root, and so that the inflation, food inflation brought to some level. Only after that we bring food inflation to level and have an equitable distribution system within the country, we can look at nutrition security and other things for the future. Today, the technological gap, I should say, is not so much. We can produce as much as required for the country. We have done so, as Professor Singh was saying. In the last 10 years, we have produced, production productivity has gone up. So productivity gap is not so much worrying to us as the distribution disadvantage, the distribution pocket.
Thank you, Mr. Patnaik. And I think, you know, your observation of policy-induced inequalities, I think that's a very important point, and the APMC Act is a prime example of policy-induced inequalities. And of course, sometimes I wonder that, you know, when would the hyperactive Supreme Court turn its attention away from micromanaging the affairs of private cricketing bodies into examining the constitution validity in terms of whether something like the APMC Act is actually consistent with the fundamental right to practice one's profession. And when would the Supreme Court wake up to the fact that this is deserving of their attention? This is within that mandate, and not maybe, you know, going into the minutiae of various policies. May I now invite other participants?
Big thing. I think as we are putting this to this, I'm beginning to realize that even without going regionally, even nationally within India, issues about technology, we already have perspectives on how important that is or how not important that is. Given, is that a constraint? Is that not a constraint? Why don't people adopt it? And there is obviously issues about the link between infrastructure and wastage. The issues about the different perspectives of market-oriented farmers and subsistence farmers. That would provide substantial, quote-unquote, content for having the kind of multi-stakeholder dialogue that, and
land and water.
And yes, and of course, what shape I'm getting people in that story, getting farmers from right from Karnataka and Tamil Nadu to get in the room would might enable people to sort of understand each other's perspective. So there is already, I mean, even without sort of the regional complication, there is a lot that one can sort of achieve even within a more controllable context.
I wanted to ask a question from the three of you, that is Mr. Anand, me, or Absar, and of course Mr. Patnaik also. We're all good friends. So do you realistically see the possibilities? Because let's face it, we are not going to have the money in the public sector to finance the kind of technology requirements that we have. I mean, in fact, I see our budgets have been going down. That people like me complain. I complain about the ICR, but I'm also a great friend of the ICR. But so the way I see it is, the public sector agencies like the ICAR and some others, maybe NITI Aayog, playing a kind of strategic role, you know, which we are talking about in these games, say next 15, 10, 5, 10, 15 years. But strategic role where we play a strategic role, but the private sector plays a very major role. And by that I mean major multinationals. Let me make it very clear, I don't like multinationals. I mean, I'm a lefty. But in this case, I know that my country needs it. We just don't have the kind of money to finance these technologies. They took me to some of their things. We just don't have those kind of billions of dollars. So let's be realistic about it. But we give them the strategic insights of the kind that we are developing in this room. Do we see that as a realistic possibility in this country? Because what I now see is, in fact, an anti-science business going on in this country in a very big way. I'm sorry, you know, as a teacher, you know, who gets a pension. And
unfortunately, that's a very vociferous group.
That's right.
But I think there is no alternative. We have to.
I mean, in my own home state, we've got an NGO, which is one of the best NGOs in India, Sadhguru. and they've introduced biotechnology. We didn't use the Monsanto thing because of its bad taste. Our own agricultural universities, Dr. R.B. Singh has said they have developed it, and there are some lunatics who have stopped it.
Yeah.
So that, you know, the Adivasi who was growing 2 quintals of maize and instead start growing 20 quintals, usko band kar diya. So, I mean, you're seeing look, in this case, the thing had been approved by regular, by scientists who are not very pro Cargill or whatever, and or, you know, or you have a very strong environment.
They do not want 20 quintals of meat, because that enables a lot more logistics and a drop in price.
So,
you must allow me a little license of, you know, pulling the legs of
No, it's okay. It is not a question of, you know, being done by a multinational or a local Indian company or a regional company. I think the need, if it has already been identified that it is required, then, you know, we have the Delhi University giving us the mustard seed indigenously, which, you know, easily, you know, can go into the fields and increase the productivity by 27% to 33% differently.
So you're telling me, I am the Vice Chancellor of the University where the first gene was patented. It's
right.
Ashish Datta,
right.
Who was my rector.
So if we leave,
patented the first gene in India.
So if we leave, you know, Cargill's, you know, the multinational companies aside, you know, for a minute, thank God that we are not into the seed business today. We are more into the food supply chain. I think the need is there.
No, I think you're being very nice and this is good public relations, but you let me create the problem. I think there is a real.
And like I said, that, you know, the, all the decisions from
top decision making levels in India, there is a problem.
Yeah.
And at best, there are problems of attitudes. At worst, there are all kinds of, you know, lobbies which are working. So it's not a non-problem.
It is.
Technology, as I said, is not technology out there. I mean, technology is developed and applied by institutions. And our institutions, there is a lot. Now, I'm a great admirer of my country, but at the same time, I know where the problems are.
And so
sorry, I'm taking you the young lady's time.
Can I invite you?
I just have a query about this innovation in Washington. So I just wanted to know, we mentioned natural resources and I want to particularly focus on soil degradation. Was this, you know, the whole concept of, you know, conserving soil and ecosystem services, was it taken into account at all, or was it looked more?
Well, you know, it was somewhere there, but you see, these countries don't face the kind of resource constraints that we face.
Yeah.
Let's face it. For us, these problems are very severe. 55 million hectares. You see, and that's a large part of our land. Even if we take the conservative, there are some fellows who make it more than 100 million hectares. So entire agricultural land in India. But it's not. These kinds of resource constraints are not the kind of severity. Remember, you know, these countries, 3% of the population is producing surplus food. So now, it's not compulsory.
So the tension there, I think, was at two levels. At one level, there was a tension between biofuels and food. That was one tension which came through in terms of this structure. That actually got resolved pretty early in the game, in terms of having a less national and a more global kind of story. And but the other place where it did go into some of that was Brazil. Delegation from Brazil. They actually sort of, because of the forest cover and managing that and red and all of that put together, there was a tension in that space. Africa was about how do I get investment to develop areas which are undeveloped land in that space. So there is, you know, that's one of the learnings is precisely this, that, you know, there will be different perspectives, there will be different groups which lead with different structures, and people might come to the same conclusion for different reasons. And so that's the, and as long as you sort of all agree to move in a particular direction for different reasons,
But the emphasis was not on 1/5 of an acre of land.
Yes, that is true.
But farmer, not the kind of farmer.
Two points. One regarding the investment private sector indulgence in the process. As a matter of fact, I hope the private sector gets into investing in research and technology development with a strategic outlook, which of course is missing today in a big way. China's total investment in biotech is more than the total investment of India's total agriculture research, ICR's total investment. But China's alone, in biotechnology alone, is more than that. In US, 70% of the US investment in biotechnology is from private sector. Only 25 to 30% is from the public sector. So what you said, sir, the strategic investment for the best of the facility. As a matter of fact, in our country, we do not have any lab in biotechnology, genomics, or genome editing today, which could be comparable to any of the labs in China or in many of the developing countries, not even one. Therefore, there is a serious gap, as a matter of fact.
No, but will, for example, some of the czars in USA, friends of yours and mine, allow that some of the best young scientists can go and work in Cargill labs in a big way.
As a matter of fact.
And, you know, wait a minute, they are a part of the core Swaminathan elite group which runs the place, okay? I mean, let's face it, I've handled the chair process for DGICAR too many times not to know the kind of stuff that goes on. See, what I'm saying is you need a different mindset.
Yes, sir.
And we have the whole past history.
It needs to happen. The industries must grow within the IRI campuses like that. They must find a place there. They must interact, and the students and the, let there be on joint appointments or something.
So let's have the first, last comment or question from the gentleman here, please.
Yeah, so I'm Sumit from WWF. Just a query, operational query.
Sorry, I need to
get WWF. WWF India. So just an operational query. I mean, this is a game, food game for the South Asian country. And
Washington was global.
Washington was global, but we are proposing for a food game in the South
Asia.
Asia.
That's for Nutan to understand.
That's what we are discussing.
That's
what we are discussing, whether to go for Asia or for India. That's what we have.
So the challenge will come, I mean, if we're considering the South Asian country to the game, and then how much complexity will come to bring those, I mean, country representative and all, seeing this political situation.
To summarize, you know, a complex and rich discussion like this is actually, you know, beyond my powers. But let me just express one thought, and I think it was this a point that you made very, very emphatically, that I hope in the next edition of this game, we introduce as players technology developers, say from the corporate sector, and we also have a number of antediluvians from the gene campaigns of the world, and let's also introduce them as players in this game, and see exactly what happens, you know, when there is this thesis, antithesis, dialectic, you know, between, I'm using the language of leftists.
Should have sat down
now. Dialectic, you know, in these games. So let us conclude the session here, and I give the floor to Uttar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'd like to thank everyone for being here, particularly the Kate and Tony, something for being late, like waking up for so late. I think it's must be 2 a.m. by this time.
Yes, absolutely.
So thank you so much, Franklin and Kate, for being with us. And do you really want to ask something? Some do you have some questions or? Hello?
Hi, Nutan. This is Franklin.
Yeah. Do you have some questions or should we wind up now?
No, I absolutely think we can wind up. Thank you all for allowing us to join you on the phone.
from so far away, and it's been a very robust discussion, so we look forward to further conversation.
Thank you. And I would like to thank Professor Ghosh for being with us, and then Professor Jayamanandra for being with us for conducting the session. And my particular thanks goes to Professor Alak for coming all the way from Ahmedabad just for this evening and accommodating our request to be here so that we can be enriched with his contribution for this discussion. And then Parker being with us, and all in spite of being there was a big change, and he could accommodate our request to be here with us. And Professor Balakrishnan, Professor Adi Singh for being with us, and all the participants for being with us, and we look forward to your contribution. This is just the beginning, so we will have a continuous interaction with all of you who designed this particular game, whether we should go for the digital, because we still are not clear whether we should go for a digital game or we should go for India game. So we will be discussing more about it later on with all of you. We will be in touch with you guys, and then probably you can provide your guidance and reflections how to go about. I'm sure we will also like to have your views on this one later on. And then so this is a continuous exercise which we want to do sometime in late 2017, and so this will be a planning to have maybe in early 2018. So this is what is the timeline which we are planning now. So we look forward to your contribution, and now I invite all of you for the WSDS sessions which are happening in the hub area, and all of you are invited for the lunch over there. So you can join the lunch, and after the lunch, we have the sessions where you can join the sessions.